Sabi Sands, South Africa. It's an absolutely beautiful morning. Actually, on the way in, it was drizzling, so we were concerned that the weather may be causing an issue here. But thankfully, as we made the half an hour journey from where we stay at night, to Juma in the Sabi Sands, the weather started to clear up, and all the clouds that were in the sky have slowly started to burn off. So the good news is we have got an excellent day weather-wise, and we've been driving for about 10 minutes so far and haven't come up with any sign or signals that any specific animals may have moved through this area, but we'll continue. I'm sure not before long we will find something interesting, be it tracks or an animal itself, time will tell. We've got Jason on camera this morning, Alex in the control. And for any of you joining for your first time, welcome on board. Good to be with us. And for all the regulars, welcome back. For those of you who may be new, it is an interactive safari, so it's possible for you to ask myself questions from anywhere you are in the world. And how to do that is on Twitter, you'd hashtag Safari Live, and on email, you just send it through to questions@wildearth.tv. So please send some questions through if there's anything you'd like to know about. Well, thankfully, because of what started off as a completely overcast morning, it's still cool. The sun hasn't been able to warm anything up yet, which actually bodes in our advantage, because hopefully, oh, there goes a duiker shooting across the road. It's going to be very difficult, but we'll try and get you a brief glimpse at it. Oh, that's okay. So there we have it, beautiful, absolutely beautiful. And we don't often get to see these animals, as they are quite shy and tend to dart off, but this one's relaxed enough even to be feeding a little bit. So I'm hesitant to start the vehicle again to get you a better angle, because it will shoot off. So let's just enjoy the slightly obstructed view we have, but all of a sudden being able to view one feeding is a bonus, a good start to the morning. Well, this is a female duiker. The male would have little horns, but what is interesting with the duiker is they do have this little tuft of hair between their ears. It is very difficult to see, but just keep an eye on it. If she does move her head into a little gap, we may be able to see that little tuft of hair. Jason's just trying to get the zooming right. It's not easy. There's so much foliage in the way. I am going to take a chance here and try and reverse a little bit to get a better gap. Oh, no, it doesn't get any better if we go back. Oh, that might be up there. Let's see if she turns her head to face us again. There's the little tuft of hair. Oh. Okay, well, we shall carry on. But wonderful to be able to show you this little grey duiker doing its business. It is the smallest find Archer out in the Sternbuck are the two smallest. Interestingly enough, you get duiker in other areas of Africa and South Africa that can be really, really tiny. A lot of them in dense forests, coastal forests. So, very cute species of antelope, the duiker, all fairly small. So having chatted with Mark yesterday evening, when he got back from his day out here, he gave me an update on what was moving around and how he did in it. It's always great to get that information, but sadly I have too much information to pass on regarding predators or any major stars that we try and look for. So this morning I'm just driving around in an area that has produced good game viewing for us in the past few weeks, and hopefully hopefully it'll continue to do the same. There's an elephant that's walked down this road dragging its trunk. It was heading in the same direction we're heading in, so that's good news, and it appears like the tracks are from sometime last night. But it appears that he veered off this way. A question has just come through from Dawn. Good morning, Dawn. Welcome to this morning's drive. Dawn asked whether duiker are usually solitary, and yes, indeed they are. As we saw with that individual over there, she was just on her own, and that is typical behavior for the duiker. Interesting tracks here. I just want to have a double check, but it looks like we have had an aardvark walking down this road last night. An incredibly rare animal to see, and we sadly certainly won't be seeing it anytime this morning. It will already be in bed. The nocturnal animal. And it's going to be very difficult for us to show you the tracks, but I'm certain it is one that passed through here. Let's see if we can try and make a plan to show you the track. I'll also be able to get it out. In my book. Are you going to be able to reach that, Dyson? Okay. No, I'm just going to jump out quickly. So those two tracks over there, folks, look like the long claws of an aardvark. Now, I'm going to just get my book out quickly, and in my book, you can see the similar are you getting that? So I hope you can see the similarity. They've got very long toes and claws, the aardvark, and these are the long toes that have come through here. It's difficult because tracks have stepped on top of other tracks, so there's a bit of an overlay. But this is indeed an aardvark came across and literally just crossed the road. We only had two tracks, one of which was on the other side of the road, and then it appeared to just cross straight across the road. But how wonderful to know that there is an aardvark amongst us, amidst us. And I've only ever seen one in the Sabi Sands, and that was actually a few weeks ago on our way back to Manuleti. And I've spent 3.5 years in this area before I came back to work here now, so your chances of seeing them are very slim. And funnily enough, aardvark are most often seen in the Sabi Sands up a marula tree, and they've got no business up a marula tree, but what they can do, what does happen, is that leopards catch them and take them up the marula tree. So that sadly is one of the only times you see them, when they're being fed on by a leopard up a tree. What we have here is a beautiful red-billed hornbill. Looks like it's just warming up, easing into the day. At this time of the year, it could well have some family responsibilities. As we've noticed quite a few of their nests around, and it appears that at the moment a lot of the females are still inside the nests and the males are, oh, there it goes. The males are spending time hunting and flying back to the nest and depositing food into the chamber that the female is waiting in while she incubates the eggs and helps raise the chicks for the first 2 weeks once they have hatched. Thereafter she also breaks out and aids the male in continuing to feed the youngsters. So I'm sure later on today that hornbill will be very busy. Okay, well, the elephants obviously veered off between these two roads because its tracks are no longer going down this road that it did turn onto. So I just thought I'd keep you updated there. But that is often what happens with animals, and when we track them, we cannot follow their every step, but rather follow their general movements into an area and drive the roads that take you through the area where you think it's heading towards. As following each individual footprints would be a very time-consuming and difficult process, especially once the animals do head off the road into the thicker vegetation. Questions just come through from Bill in Michigan. Good morning, Bill. Welcome on board. Bill is asking whether aardvark are dangerous in any way, and no, they are not. They are a nocturnal animal, as I said, that feed on termites, and they are of no danger to humans. They are, I guess, predators in their own right, and that they kill termites for a living, but they are of no threat to us, and I know of no incidents where they would have caused harm to a human. They do like danger to humans. They are, I guess, predators in their own right. And the clouds have began to roll back in, so it cleared up initially this morning, and then slowly, as you can see, Jason's giving a better angle of the clouds now. The clouds have built up a little bit, but that is good for us for now, for the time being. As long as these clouds don't bring any rain, the cool weather that they bring is greatly appreciated and beneficial for us and the game viewing. The cooler it is, the animals will be moving about. Apologies, I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel. There's a bit of chatter there now, so I'm just listening in on what's going on, and sadly I only caught the second half of it, so I can't give you any updates as to what exactly they were saying. All I heard was that somebody was using their GPS because they were in a very thick bush, but I'll continue to listen. Some really pretty birds here called white-crested helmet shrikes. They're just fluttering across. I hope they're going to land. They've gone. But if they had have stuck around, we would have certainly have stopped to show you them. They've got very, very unique coloration and markings, the white-crested helmet shrike, with the yellow rings around their eyes, and very pretty little birds. But sadly this morning, they were not interested in showing us their beauty. And the Game Drive channel was volleying. Affirmative. I didn't copy your second, but I came through. Now I think you said something about buffalo. Okay, well, it appears our luck has changed, folks. We didn't stumble upon this vehicle. I knew that we'd see some here, and I'm just traversing now to try and get us into a position where we will get the best view of these animals. So don't go anywhere. We do have to be in the screen in your shot, so a few moments while we get into position. Vehicle in this sighting, so I'll bear that in mind. Oof. Wow. I'm just gonna stop over here and then Jason will pan across to this animal. It's just behind us over here. Now what you should be able to make out now is the form of a lion in the grass. It's fast asleep, as you can see, and didn't even lift up its head to have a look at us when we arrived. It looks to be, just from this initial glimpse and from the area that they're in, that it could be one of the Birmingham coalition. And the three of them were feeding on a buffalo up until the day before yesterday. I don't think Mark had any luck finding them yesterday. But here they are now and still recovering from 3 days of intensive feeding on a buffalo that the three of them managed to bring down. Usually there are five of them together, but they did get split up into a group of three and a group of two, and we're not sure exactly why they were split up. They could have come across some other males that chased them away, and in that chaos they may have lost two members of the coalition. I'm sure they'll reunite, and it's not uncommon for coalitions to split up. But at the moment we can only see one. I do know though from the radio chatter that there were three here in this general area. Hard to believe, even though we know that there are three here, we cannot see the other two. Jason, can you see the other two?
No, I'm looking.
Now at the moment, as you can see, they are not doing a hell of a lot, so not ideal for our viewing, but what we can, what we do know is that if some buffalo started walking past now, they would certainly change tune. The chances of that happening are slim, but we'll wait here for a few moments, and if the sun continues to beat down on him like it does, there's a chance he'll get up and move to some shade. So we'll wait here a few moments, and also once this other vehicle leaves, we will we'll snoop around and see if we can find the other two individuals. Let's try maybe zoom in on him now, because he may pick up his head as they leave. And that way at least you can get a glimpse, or a better glimpse of this animal. But no, he's merely twitching his ear very slightly, just listening to the audio of the vehicle leaving. And comatose from too much buffalo meat. This coalition is proving to be a highly formidable buffalo hunting unit, and as far as I know, the only thing since I've been here is buffalo, or at least that's what we've seen. So it must be noted that it's not easy to take down a buffalo, so these five young males are doing a great job, and when five males do band together, they do get the benefits of all the strength of them combined, and this does allow them to take down huge prey like buffalo that can feed them for 3 or 4 days. Well, what I'm going to do is have a quick trail around and see if we can find the other individuals. I've got a question that's just come through from Tamara. Morning, Tamara. How are you doing? Now, Tamara's asked whether, now that they have been separated from a coalition that was usually 5 to one of 3 and 2, how would they be able to communicate, to rejoin? And they certainly can communicate by vocalizing or roaring. And their roar is audible from the human ear from about 6 miles away, so a very, very long way off. And that's just with our ears. So with their incredible hearing, they'll probably hear 3 or 4 times that, at least. And that is usually how they would communicate in order to reunite. They can also follow scent trails. They will know the scents of certain individuals of their coalition. So if they were to come across a path where one had walked, probably within 1 or 2 days even, they'd follow that scent trail. Now, probably males face to, and they don't have their big male. Okay. Apologies again, first. I'm not sure how long you broke up for, but I will continue to answer tomorrow's question. Now, we just do have a beautiful view of this one male here, then I'm just going to try and get into position and let you have a look at him. Beautiful. Well, a far better view than the one we were looking at originally, so I'm glad we moved. And look at how beautiful this animal is. Absolutely beautiful. He's already got a few scratches on his nose. Those are probably all from family members at this stage, squabbling over meat, fighting between his brothers and other coalition members that are probably his cousins. There are 3 of these individuals that look the same size, and these are the 3 that we have in our view, but with us at the moment. And then one larger and one smaller, and it's the larger one and the smaller one that I believe are missing from these 3 brothers. And the older one and the younger one are probably their cousins. But back to Tamara's question. Tamara asked how would these 3 be able to reunite with the other coalition members, and they'd be able to do that by 2 different main ways would be their best bet, and one would be to vocalize. And this is a loud roar that is even audible to the human ear from about 6 miles away. So even if, and lions have obviously got much better hearing than us, so they can probably hear up to 20 or 30 kilometers or miles away when other lions vocalize. So what's important to realize is that because these guys are young, their manes aren't fully developed, they will not want to get themselves into confrontational scenarios yet, but by vocalizing they would be letting all the other dominant males in this area know their whereabouts, and these dominant males might come in and try and chase them. So for these 3 to vocalize now would be an unwise move, because it would attract unwanted attention to them. Another way that they would be able to reunite is by simply walking around. They could pick up the scent of their other 2 members and follow those scent trails. Even if the other members passed by a day or 2 before, they would know the scent of their cousins or brothers, coalition members, and certainly be able to follow the scent trail of where they moved. So I don't think we have anything to worry about. They will reunite. It's just a matter of when, in all likelihood. I'm just going to move forward a little bit. We've appeared to have got our best view from this individual. And I'm just assuming that it's not going to be long before the other one that's lying in the shade gets up and finds some, that's lying in the sun, sorry, gets up to position us in an area where hopefully we can keep a view on both of them. I think that's probably still your best bet there, Jason. If you're going onto that one there. As the one in the sunlight is still completely flat, but by being here, if he does get up and join his coalition members, we are going to be in the best spot. So we'll just try and preempt their movements. The very important thing when filming wildlife and photographing wildlife is trying to get yourself into the correct position before the animals do whatever it is you're trying to capture. It certainly is the trickiest part of filming or photographing these animals. So let's see if this plan of ours does pay off, but at this stage these three are certainly looking very relaxed. But if any animals were to start walking past, they certainly would have a go at them. The ideal animal for that for them to hunt would be buffalo, as I mentioned earlier, so that is what we'd want to come ideally. It is a large misconception that the male lions don't hunt or that they are not good hunters. They certainly are, especially when it comes to taking down the bigger prey members, such as the buffalo. So don't be fooled, they are formidable hunters. They may just be lazy when the ladies are around. And not only lady, greedy and a little bit unfair in that they will often consume the most meat and get the best position on a kill, even if they did not necessarily lend a hand in making it. But in the same breath, there's a lot of times where the big strong males will be vital to the females and helping bring down the bigger prey. So they can hunt, and they also do spend a lot of time away from the females. Males are predominantly alone. Unless females have food or are in season, it's more important for the males to be out expanding their territory, monitoring their territory, making sure there's no intruders. So they do actually spend the majority of the time alone, even when they are dominant, which these young boys certainly are not yet. Now, sadly for us, but luckily for the lion that's out in the sun, the clouds are coming in and keeping it cool despite it being out in the open. So my predictions for it to get up due to the heat are becoming less and less likely as these clouds come over. We've got a question that's just come through from Christine. Morning, Christine, and welcome on board. Christine is asking whether male lions groom one another, and they certainly would. All the members of this coalition will bond heavily with one another and also groom one another. So that is certainly something we could expect to see if they were a little bit more active. Or if one animal had a wound, you often find other animals coming and licking that wound to try and keep it clean. So they are affectionate amongst one another. Oh, we may have a little bit of movement coming here. We do indeed, a little stretch, but that's it. Did you get that, Jason?
Yeah.
Sorry, folks, the screen that... Oh, there we go. What can you smell? What are you doing? Okay. Well, the other one that we were viewing has now gone completely flat, and I think Jason's trying to show you one of its paws that it's got propped up against the tree, but it's certainly not easy to see. But they often do that when they are lying under these small shady bushes. They'll use the branches to help the supports for various limbs when they're on their back. Sorry, Alex, if we could just go again with that question, please. A question that's just come through from Mike in Bristol. Good morning, Mike. How are you doing? Welcome on board this morning, and glad to have you with us. Mike is asking whether, if a pride of lioness came into this area now and there were some females in season, would these coalition members fight between one another for mating rights? And they certainly would. I've seen some colossal battles between coalition members over females, so they certainly can do that and will do that. So the benefits of them being a coalition is that by the fact that there are five of them, it makes hunting easier, it makes defending a territory easier, and also acquiring a big territory becomes easier with five males. Five males is a big coalition. You seldom get bigger than that, but occasionally there have been records of six or seven males in a coalition. But sadly, when it does come to mating, only one of them gets to do it a lot of the time, and they will fight between one another for it. It does vary a lot. Just like humans, if you could think of a sports team, for example, you may get one player who's playing exceptionally well for a period of time, and then he may lose condition, and another player might start playing better than him. So it can be the same for a coalition of lions. One may be the biggest and strongest for a period of time, but as time goes on, he may lose that skill. So there are fights that happen, but once a fight has happened and they have established who's dominance, I think it takes a while before they're likely to get into another big fight. Unnecessarily, they'll remember and know who the boss is amongst themselves. But yeah, they would certainly fight. And with this coalition in specific, it would be interesting to see, because there is one that is considerably larger than the rest of them. So I think for now, he's going to be in charge, but that will change over time. There'll probably be a few more years before they are dominant in any way. So I think their chances of mating are slim in the next few years. So until then, there shouldn't be too much fighting amongst them. Can hear a tree squirrel alarm calling, probably at the line. I'm gonna try and see if I can find it. in the tree, because it's funny to watch them when they do perform their alarm call. Whole tail vibrates. Where are you hiding, little squirrel? Well, I'm not sure how much longer what you got there, Ramya?
Just looking for a squirrel.
Okay, so Ramya is searching for the squirrel that we can hear alarming intermittently. There are a few crested barbets jumping around that tree. That's one on the back of the shot. But sadly it is so thick that not gonna be able to get a good focus on that. But there were a few crested barbets hopping around that tree. But no sign of the squirrel. I'm sure it is in that tree that we're looking through. But it has stopped alarming now. Okay, well, I think this evening is going to be a far better opportunity for us to come and spend time with these lions. So until then, the sleepy lion will be left alone. And we shall continue. I look for something a little bit more lively. Eight. Good. Okay, so just over an hour left. Let's see what that time will provide us with. Responses there, but there was a sighting of a leopard quite far from where we were initially, but now it has become a little bit closer to us. It was just before we got into that lion sighting that I heard that a leopard had been located. So I'm just going to see how many vehicles are in that area. And hopefully, if there's not too many, we'll be able to squeeze in a glimpse of it. I'm not sure if it's a male or a female. I haven't heard too much, but while we make our way in general direction, the radio comms should increase, and I'll get a better idea of exactly what's going on. But that is what we are heading towards, potentially. A leopard sighting, so that's always good. sorry, I was just making sure the radio hadn't been bumped onto a different channel, so we're all good there. Alright, please have an update on the Ingwer sighting. Seem to be working, but thankfully I know fairly well where they were with this leopard. It's about 10 minutes from where we are at a leisurely pace like this, and despite not having any radio comms ensuring that we would be allowed to go in there and view them, I am going to take a chance. The reason I say if there would be space for us, we limit sightings to 3 vehicles in this area, and it certainly is a very good method and way of viewing animals without impacting too much on them, as well as just for the viewers and people on the vehicles. It is more enjoyable if there are less people around. It allows the few vehicles that are there to get good positions and good views. Therefore, on the radio, I'd usually get an update as to how many vehicles were in the sighting. We've just got 2 warthog walking out of shot, but at least it is a shot nonetheless of warthog, which we don't see too often. Good. Okay. I'm picking up better radio comms now, which is good. To have what I'm hoping will be a glorious view of a very, very pretty bird. Called the lilac-breasted roller. And it's just perched up on this branch. Beautiful. Now, I'm hoping it's going to reposition or fly off, because their side profile is beautiful, and when they do take off, there's a beautiful turquoise color on their wings that we can see. There's just a game viewer that's arrived, and they're just making sure they don't interfere with our broadcast very kindly. So I was just giving them a few hand signals now to let them know to carry on in. And they are making their way past, and While they do that, let's just keep an eye on this lilac crested rudder. It may decide to fly off as they come past. Morning. How are you doing? Very good, very good. I'm Scott. Yeah, very nice to meet you. Scott. Did you guys find the leopard?
Yeah.
Well done.
Oh, I'll tell you what. He was our spotter, Ben at the back.
Okay.
And then we went through the bush. It was incredible. Are you looking for him?
Yeah, we're going to make our way down there slowly and, yeah, hopefully. Well, there was a lilac breasted runner that obviously just took off shortly ago, yeah, but we were viewing, viewing that initially.
Where's the crew from?
We are from Joburg, yeah.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. And just here for a few more weeks, so it should be good.
Lovely.
So what's your mission then?
We're broadcasting live, so at the moment people all over the world are watching that dead tree, or watching me actually, on the internet. So it's live streamed.
For a small price. I am the manager.
So yeah, that's what we're doing. We're just broadcasting live game drives to whoever wants to watch. Cool. A little bit, but not enough. So I would love to spend more time with him. Cool, Phil. Well, nice to meet you. Have a great morning, folks, and thanks for finding the leopard.
Cheers.
That was a very friendly old man. So we don't get to meet up with or see new faces very often. So when we do, it's so great. And especially when they are the ones that found a leopard for us. But I'm not sure if we're going to make it there. Let's hope for the best. It's a beautiful big male leopard. What's the vehicle movement there, please? I'm just wondering what the vehicle movement is. If there's sorry, if I will get back to you now. I'm just gobbling what's going on. Okay, folks. Sorry about the breakup. Welcome back. Good news is there's one space for us. There's two vehicles in this leopard sighting, but now we just need to establish how the best, well, what the best route is to get there. Philemon's cut plan. So try and get there as quick as possible. Ephraim, yes, I'm heading south on Balanates from Zoe's Junction. Okay, copy, thank you. All these signal breakups make it difficult for me to remember what has been seen and what hasn't been seen. or what you have heard me say, or what you haven't heard me say. So we are on our way to hopefully view a very large male leopard. I've only had one brief sighting of him, and he is a beautiful individual. He is on the move though, and it is quite thick, so I'd like to try and get there quickly before the vehicles potentially lose him, or he goes into an area that we cannot follow him in. The great thing about this vehicle is that it is very maneuverable, and far more maneuverable than the regular game views, which are considerably longer. So by us being there, it also ensures that there's a stronger chance of staying with them through the thicker vegetation. Alex, sorry, I've just turned off your audio, so I'm not hearing anything you're saying. I'm just listening to the radio so I can try and get into the sighting. Okay, well, I've just seen another vehicle heading off-road, so hopefully we are in the right spot. There he is. Okay, we're good. Okay, just seeing where he's heading now, folks, and I want to just get ahead of him quickly to get a good view. Ephraim did a great job guiding us in here to the sighting. There are some impala in the area, but they are in a bit of a clearing, and there's also some buffalo. Now, as you can see, folks, it is very thick, but I did get a glimpse of him heading towards us here. Okay. Will he pop out here for us? Oh, there's a beautiful smell of the aniseed that we're driving over. Now, where will he pop out? Or will he pop out? Oof. This is not easy. It's going to require a little bit of backwards and forth to establish which path exactly he's taken. But he was heading towards us. Where is he gone? Good on yourself. Okay, folks, so there's two of us looking around here and there's no sign of him popping out where initially I was hoping he would, judging from the brief glimpse I got of him earlier. It looked like he was heading towards us. But sadly, there doesn't appear to be any sign of him. A very good indicator to us would be birds' alarm calling as he moves through the vegetation. He could also well have just laid down. Somewhere here. So, we're just gonna have to hope for the best now, because one of many things could have happened in terms of what he's done, and sadly, just due to this very thick vegetation, go ahead.
Hello everyone. Being out in the bush and being out there live has its technical challenges. We're experiencing some of that now and are working on it as fast as possible to get it sorted and get you back in the vehicle with us. Hello everyone. Being out in the bush and being out there live has its technical challenges. We're experiencing some of that now and are working on it as fast as possible to get it sorted and get you back in the vehicle with us. Hello everyone. Being out in the bush and being out there live has its technical challenges. We're experiencing some of that now and are working on it as fast as possible to get it sorted and get you back in the vehicle with us.
Two, one. Welcome back, and again, apologies for the breakup in signal. Thankfully, you haven't missed anything. I had a very, very brief glimpse of the rear end of Mvula heading through this very thick vegetation and looped ahead to try and get to a clear spot where he could well pop out, but that did not happen. He did not do as I was hoping he would do and walk in towards a little clearing that he was heading towards. And now there are three vehicles here looking for him, trying to find him. But so far, unsuccessfully. I would like to try and search a little bit more as our vehicle is more maneuverable than the other vehicles, the other game viewers. Watch out here, Jason. And just by putting ourselves in this area, there is a chance we'll see him, but it's not great. That's for sure. It's just too thick in here, and he could have laid down, changed direction, headed anywhere really. People have a visual. Can does anybody have a visual of Mvula at the moment? Or is that guy just waiting for it to pop out, hopefully? Well, either way, he's not answering his radio, so we will simply continue with our little mission. And at the moment, that is to cross. Ooh, hold on. No, this isn't looking like a wise move. So we will not cross this riverbed unnecessarily, because there's a large stump that is just going to get in our way. Damage the vehicle, so I would not want to risk. So well, that is disappointing, and I did try and warn you that there is a chance we wouldn't be able to get a visual of this animal, because it so often does happen when a leopard is on the move that you cannot stay with them, especially if they're moving through thick vegetation. And that is what has happened today. Jason didn't even get a view of it. I just had a brief glimpse. To give you an idea of how thick it is here and difficult to see or spot and follow the animals. Oh, that's frustrating. I really wanted to have a good look at Mvula again. He's a beautiful leopard. Just want to go and check one last spot. Actually, it's far too thick in here. So what may be more beneficial to us is to now loop ahead further than, well, a lot further, because in the 10 minutes now that we've spent looking around for him in the same spot, he could well have traveled a long distance in the same direction that he was heading. And he was heading predominantly south, according to the people that had been following him. So we will continue south down this road and see what happens. He is also very close to a boundary road that he may get onto, which runs parallel to the road we're on now. something that you do have to bear in mind when you do lose an animal is that every minute that you spend in the same place, it can be covering large distances. And what I'm hoping for is that we may find him on this main road here. Because he was veering to the west ever so slightly. And we may just get lucky with him coming out. Anywhere here, he was coming kind of towards us in this direction. When I did have a brief glimpse of him. Just gonna stop here and wait for a second or two. By having the vehicle off, there's a chance we may hear his alarm calls. Sorry, not his alarm calls, animals alarm calling at him.
Scott.
Yes, sir.
There's a giant stick insect.
Where?
On your seat.
On my seat?
Yeah, right here.
Okay. Oh, nice. Well, sadly the stick insect fell into a little crack that he's going to have to find his own way out of now, trying to get him out the vehicle back into a more natural habitat for him. But there was a small stick insect crawling around on the back of my seat. Coming down the road towards us, also potentially searching for this animal. Morning, how are you doing?
By yourself?
Yeah, very good, thanks.
Good. Yeah, you guys missed the Madash.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but they went south, eh?
Okay.
Yes.
Did you have a good sighting?
Eh?
Good sighting?
Yeah.
Cool.
There was like 8 vehicles in like 10 minutes.
Okay. Awesome, man.
Enjoy.
Cool, have a good morning. Cheers. Yeah, yeah. Oh, they got lucky, they saw some wild dog this morning. Sadly, they were on a property that we cannot traverse. And sadly, the pack didn't head any closer towards us. They actually headed further south away from us, so that's a pity. Looking very promising here, but I am going to do one more loop through this area. We might get lucky. If not, we will move on and see what else is going on out there. we are also sadly very close to one of our boundaries. Well, we're on one of our boundaries. Anything to the right we cannot go on. And the leopard was moving from left to right. So there's a strong chance if he didn't already cross over this road that he is going to. Beautiful big wildebeest bull here that we passed on our way out, and he's distanced himself slightly from all the females and their calves who are just ahead of him to the left. Oh, you can hear some starlings really making a racket about us here. Okay, copy. Well done, thanks. I will come back and join you now. Sorry, can you go again with the second half of that message? Well, another game viewer has somehow managed to regain a brief visual of the Mvula, this leopard we've been looking for. Thanks very much. Okay, well, the other vehicle, which is close to us, says he did last see him heading towards us. The other vehicle was just in the bush ahead of us there. So, things are looking up again. Where could he be? How long ago did you have that visual? Okay, copy, thanks. Okay, thank you. Well, we saw him a few minutes ago, very briefly, and he said that the leopard was heading towards us, but the problem is if he headed towards us 5 minutes ago, he could be anywhere now. Where to check next? Certainly is worth us trying our best to get a visual of this animal. He is exceptionally beautiful, the dominant male in this area. So we will try everything in our power to find him again, because to race off now into an area where we don't have any clue of a leopard being there would be, I think, silly, considering we know there is a leopard here somewhere. It's worth checking around as much as possible. Small riverbed that I'm trying to, that he appears to have been following, and I'm just trying to get around as much of it as I can to see if he isn't still in fact in it. It's just so thick. I'm trying to see if I can see any of his tracks in the sand of the riverbed, but no luck. Now, I really just don't know what to do. We'll give it a few more minutes. There's the other vehicle still here also searching, so While he is here, we may as well stay. And search for a few more minutes. No, no luck. Copy, yeah, I'm just trying to follow this cover as much as I can, but no sign of him. Copy, good idea. Okay, well, sadly, it appears that Mvula is not wanting to cooperate with us this morning, which is fine. That's how it goes sometimes, but apologies, it is frustrating. I was getting so excited to see him. And then when I did have that initial glimpse, I was confident we were at least going to be able to show you one or two spots along the way, but no luck. And now we will head on to plan D for the morning, which is to head along the break and then slowly make our way back towards quarantine clearing, see what's going on there. Is it back?
Yeah.
Copy, thanks Andrew. I'm also just moving out. So I came along the Gowrie cut line and then now I'm heading north. Okay, the stick insects. Hold on 1 second. Let me just stop the car here. Wonderful. So here we have it. A six-legged stick insect. And as you can see, from its body shape, it is very stick-like. And that is what they do to camouflage themselves and protect themselves from any prey, or predators rather. They are such cool little animals. I mean, imagine having a body shape like that. Incredible, beautiful, beautiful camouflage on it as well. It looks just like a little stick. And that is what we need to now find for him. There's a stick to place him on. So, we will do that now. I don't think he was having too much fun on the Land Rover. So we will just release him here. And what I'll do is once we have released him, I'll just reverse a little bit and see if Jason can get an angle on it for you. Oof, I can't even see it anymore, which doesn't make it. Okay, let me jump out. Let me jump out, and what I'll do is I'll put something behind it so that you can see. Better. So you should be able to see it outlined there. And how's it looking there, Jason?
Oh, give me a second. You move the book that way a little bit. There we go. Perfect.
Good. So, as you can see, as I remove the book, not easy to see there, and that's how they evade being eaten by a lot of birds. I'm sure would enjoy stepping on them. We're all in one piece in control there. Okay, could be, thanks. parrot calling. I'm just trying to work out where it is. And then we can try and show it to you. They are hard to force to show you the brown-headed parrots. They don't often present themselves in the open. They are usually hidden in the canopy of the trees that they're feeding in. And this one that let off a few squawks has now gone quiet. Interested to know if the tracks we had of Mvula, well not of Mvula, apologies, of a large male leopard that passed by Buffalsook Dam at some stage last night weren't indeed his tracks. They can cover huge distances when they want to. So he may have had a seriously long mission last night. One of the bumpiest stretches of road on the property, but it's only for 20 meters or so. Karula is. There's been no sign of her for a few days. So hopefully it won't be long before she's back, or at least not necessarily back, but we've got an idea of what she's up to. She could well be back and we just don't know about it. But it would be nice to see her, and I'm sure it won't be long before she is mating. She could already be mating now, so to keep a track of her over the next few days would be wonderful. Because to see leopard mating would be really wonderful. Again, I haven't seen mating for about 4 years now. Closer to three and a half years since I left the Sabi Sands. And that itself paints a picture as to how good the leopard viewing is here relative to other wilderness areas where I worked subsequently after leaving here. On the road, it's hilarious what it's done to its body. Really puffed it up. And froze with its tail directly in the air. So it's assumed the warthog stance, but unlike warthog that put their tails up when they're running, this chameleon has put its tail up. In horror, as it saw the vehicle coming towards it, it just froze completely. And by freezing completely, it becomes less animal-like. Now it's beginning to wobble, and it'll probably wobble itself into a slow zigzagging not zigzagging, but kind of back and forth walk as it... It's awesome. It's watching us with that one eye bending back, looking at us. And wouldn't it be wonderful to be able to move your eyes like that? Again, like I said, as soon as he feels more comfortable that we don't want to eat him, I'm sure he will start walking. And incredible to see that his coloration is quite similar to that of the road. Not perfect, but quite similar to that of the road. And let's see if we can't get him to cross the road here. He's going to get into his walking motion now. He's just doing it very slowly, because by moving very slowly, he becomes a lot less apparent to any predators. And by bobbing backwards and forwards slowly, it could simulate being a leaf or some inanimate object. What is its plan going to be? Because usually they would have carried on walking by now, but this one I did get quite close to. I saw it quite late. And I think he just got very scared that we're going to run him over. I can't believe how straight its tail is up in there as well. It's hilarious. But here it goes now. It's getting into the rhythm and it's going to start doing this funny toing and froing kind of dance move as it slowly steps, it makes its way forward. Not sure if Jason can maybe try and darken the shot just a little bit. There we go. Perfect. Look at that tail. Incredible. I've never seen them do this. It's obviously trying to start a new trend, this guy. Because this vertical tail really is something strange. And there, maybe you'll see him start to flatten it as he gets closer. Oh, look at that. And now he's really in the swing of things. And it looks like it is going to make it into the safety of the vegetation. I'm just going to try and get us alongside it so we can hopefully see any coloration changes as it does get in there, but it looks like we are going to battle to see it now as it gets into this. Nah. Once it gets in there, it will be close to impossible to see it, understandably, as it is a chameleon. But I am almost tempted to see where it goes and what it does. We've only got a few minutes left, so there's a large tree that it may start to make its way up. It'll be beautiful to watch. Let's see what happens here. Now, you're not going to be able to see it initially because we're too close with the vehicle, but it's important for us to keep an eye on it this way and just establish whether it is going to go anywhere. Jason, can you see it?
I cannot see it.
It would really just be nice for us to be able to show you its change in coloration as it's got into this greener foliage off the yellow sandy road. But it's doing what chameleons do best, and that is changing their color to fit in with their surroundings, therefore making it difficult for anyone to see them, predators and prey items. And now I think it's fair to say that it has completely eluded myself and Jason. Hey, incredible. I mean, it is thick, so it could be hidden below some of the foliage. Then again, it also could be not hidden completely by foliage and just hidden by its incredible camouflage. So either way, it's done a disappearing act. Good, well, always cool to see the chameleons. And glad I did manage to spot that one at the last second. You sadly do see quite a few of them squashed on the roads. Them and tortoises are sadly not well equipped for being seen when people are driving on these roads. So, just about 10 minutes left, just under. Potential warning, I could be wrong, but you can feel the strong wind coming, but you can't feel, we can feel the wind, you can maybe see the leaves blowing and hear the wind on the mic, that there's wind picking up now, and this wind could be bringing the clouds in from the south, and that is where the wet weather comes from. Hopefully this afternoon we continue to stay dry, but there is a chance that there will be rain this afternoon judging by the weather. Although every time I've said that over the last few days I've been completely wrong, and come the afternoon there's not a cloud in the sky. I just want to see if we can make it to quarantine clearings for the last few minutes of drive. We're not far from there now, and hopefully we'll have general game to look at. There's also the hornbill's nest that we know of, so we may be able to get a flyby of the hornbill as he comes in to deposit food to the lady in the nest. And that's what this hornbill here is about to do as it flies off. Let's watch close. Welcome back. Sorry about the delays in broadcast or breakups in broadcast. I hope the tech geniuses in Cape Town and London and wherever they are going to be able to get to the bottom of this soon, because it is highly frustrating for you and me and everyone involved in this operation. So let's hold thumbs for the tech geniuses. Either way, again, sorry for the breakups and broadcast on the drive today. There was a long one at one stage. Anyway, there's just a few minutes left, so for those of you that have stayed on through all of these technical issues, thank you. And I'm sorry we didn't get to see that glimpse of Mvula. We were so close, but just luck wasn't on our side this morning, which is fine because we certainly have had a lot of luck over the last few days, so not complaining. And also good prospects for this evening, those three lions that we had a look at. They are, I'm hoping, going to be a little bit more active and enthusiastic this evening, so that is something to look forward to. But from myself and Jason, as well as from Alex, thanks very much for joining us. And I hope you have a wonderful day or night, depending on where you are in the world. And until this afternoon, which hopefully won't be raining. I've got a feeling it might be there. But like I said, I've been miscalling my rain predictions over the last few days. There's a Batalea soaring up above us, and that'll be a great shot to close on. So let's see if we can get Jason into a position where we can film it. And we might just get lucky. Okay. There we go. Let's see. Hopefully it continues flying the way it is, and then we should be able to get a decent view of it teetering through the air. Beautiful. Sadly, when it comes too close to us, the camera can't leave up. It's literally looking right down at us now, but the camera can't leave her up that high. Now it's going out again, so it should come back into screen. There we go. Oh, nice. Well done, Jason. It looks to be a juvenile Batalea. It doesn't have its full adult coloration, or didn't appear to. But that was a beautiful view of the Batalea soaring along. You can now hear a crested barbet calling in this marula tree in front of us on the left of the screen, but can't see the bird itself. Let me creep forward one last time and see if we can get a few more shots of the Batalea, or has it disappeared completely? Oh no, there it is. Okay, well, from myself, Jason and Alex, thank you very much for joining us this morning, and until this afternoon, this Batalea will close out for us, soaring through the air.